My name's Anisa Visram. I'm a lecturer in audiology here at the University of Manchester, and I was the lead author on a research study on aided infant cortical evoked potentials, also known as the Ladies in the Van study. We do aided cortical testing because we want to know whether someone can hear sounds through a hearing aid. So particularly we're interested in things like speech sounds, so real life sounds that the person might want to hear. We're particularly interested in doing aided cortical testing on patient groups who are not able to perform behavioural testing. So one group where this is particularly significant is young babies around about age 3 to 7 months old. So they'll tend to be a little bit too old for ABR, but a little bit too young to do VRA. And we know that we're fitting hearing aids to children in this age group. So aided corticals can be really useful to give us some idea about whether they're hearing sounds through those hearing aids. So, as with most types of testing, everything's a lot harder and more complicated the younger kids you start testing. So, one of the things that we want to have with cortical testing is we want the patients to be awake and alert, because this can affect the response. So for younger kids, keeping them awake sometimes can be a challenge. As well as wanting them to be awake and alert, we also want them to be quite still and quite quiet. So this is another thing that's quite challenging for young babies. Vocalizations can particularly have an impact on the response. Another important factor is that the morphology of the response looks very different at different ages. So the cortical response doesn't fully mature until round about adolescence. And one of the things this means is when we're interpreting the responses, they can look very different. So you can pretty much guess what a cortical response is going to look like in an adult. For babies, particularly when we're looking at aided responses, they're a lot more variable, so they can be a bit more complex to interpret. So as well as looking at the morphology of a response to decide whether a response is present, it's really valuable when looking at aided corticals to use an objective measure, particularly for infants where the responses are very variable. One of the measures that has most typically been used is a Hertelling's T-squared test. So this is quite a simple sort of statistical objective measure that essentially just looks at whether the overall set of responses is different to zero. So it's quite a simple measure. And we can make some slight modifications to that procedure, which we've found can help to improve the sensitivity of detection for smaller sample sizes. And that's obviously really useful when we're testing babies and want to get our testing done as quickly and efficiently as possible. So when working with babies, as I've mentioned, it can be difficult sometimes to make sure they stay awake, alert, quiet. So that's one of the challenges. Another really important thing is to make sure that people working with the test understand how to interpret the results. So we can have these objective measures to look at whether a response is present, but we also know that we don't consistently see responses present every time the sound is heard. So sometimes we need to look at doing repeat testing. And when we're doing repeat testing, it's really important to understand the statistical parameters that go into interpreting those results to make sure that we don't overinterpret. So it's really important to have quite a deep understanding of how the test works and how the statistics works to be able to interpret correctly. So in our research study, it took an average of 24 minutes to complete the test, which included preparation time and testing at two different frequencies. In the real world, that number's likely to vary. We really generally expect that the test will be a bit more efficient out there in the real world because the clinical protocol is a bit simplified compared to the research one. So it is a little bit different working with those younger children than the way you would sort of work with and engage children for VRA. What we tended to find was that certain toys worked really well to sort of mesmerise the kids and keep them quiet. Some kids really responded to mirrors, some kids really responded well to sort of bright flashing toys and lights that would really keep them kind of just staring but not talking. So the need for the research really came about before I was on board with the project, and there was a sort of ideas coming from various directions. So clinicians, parents and researchers were all really aware that there was this sort of gap in a baby's testing schedule when they were aged between about 3 months and 7 months, so too old for ABR, too young for VRA, but still fitted with hearing aids. And parents, clinicians, everybody wanted some more information about how well those babies were hearing through the hearing aids, and that's where the research began. So in order to do this research, we want to find out how we can use aided cortical evoked potentials on infant hearing aid users. So we needed to go out and reach a large number of infant hearing aid users. To do this, we commissioned a research van with a soundproof booth in the back so that we could drive out to families and visit them in their homes. So this made it a really accessible study for families, whereas it would have been very, very difficult for those families from all over the country to come and travel to us. So we had 103 babies take part in the study in total, and we recruited them from all over the country. So we drove the van all the way down to Cornwall and all the way up to Inverness. So we had a really good representation from all over the country. The stimuli were developed here in Manchester, primarily by our collaborator, Professor Michael Stone. So the idea behind the sounds is that we wanted to create sounds that had speech-like qualities, but that were steady state in nature and also frequency specific. So the reason behind this is we want them to have speech-like qualities so that the hearing aids recognise them as speech. So we know that when we're doing the aided corticals, we're getting appropriate amplification through the hearing aid. And we did do research to check how these sounds came out when they were played through hearing aids. And that did show that they were coming out with the correct amount of amplification. Another important factor in the sounds is how they're calibrated. So we calibrate these sounds relative to the international speech spectrum. So we call that dB speech reference level. So what this means is if we play a sound out at 65 dB speech reference level, the energy contained in that sound is equivalent to the energy in 65 dB frequency speech in that equivalent frequency band. And essentially what this means is the types of sounds that we're using relate to and are equivalent to the way we fit hearing aids in test boxes. Another thing that's important with these signals is their frequency specificity. So sometimes when we're doing speech testing, you might want to use a broader band signal that sounds more like realistic speech. But the problem with that is if you get a response, you don't know which frequency components caused that response. So which frequency components were heard through the hearing aid by the patient. So where we have a nice frequency specific signal, if we see a response, we know that the patient is hearing those frequencies in particular. We started by measuring the cortical response to conversational level speech. So what we then want to know is, were those cortical signals played at a conversational level audible through the hearing aid? So to do that, we have to go back and see the babies when they're ready to do VRA. So we then use the same setup, so the same signals, the same hearing aid, to do a VRA measurement to find out the quietest level of sound that those babies can hear. So this lets us know whether that original conversational level cortical signal was audible and at what level. In a single session, we recorded 160 sweeps for each of two different frequencies. And we recorded these in two separate blocks of 80 each, so we could look at the two averages overlaid over each other. We also alternated between the mid-frequency and the high-frequency stimulus after every 20 sweeps, and this was to avoid any effects of habituation. The first thing that the study showed was the feasibility of the test. So we had a 99% completion rate, showing that it's a really feasible test to perform clinically. The really important key data is about the sensitivity of the test. So how often do we see a response when the signal is audible and at what level? So for increasing sensation levels, we saw that we were more likely to see a response. And when you include the effect of repeat testing, we start to see some really high sensitivities, making it a feasible test, particularly for the mid-frequency. So as we knew from previous studies, what we find is that we don't always see a cortical response when we know that the stimulus is audible. And we also see that the sensitivity is slightly lower for the higher frequency signal than the mid-frequency signal. But another thing that we found is that when we repeat the test, we increase the sensitivity quite a bit. We already know from previous studies we don't always see a response when the stimulus is audible, and we wanted to look into that a little bit more. So we wanted to know, if you don't see a response, is that something consistent in a particular individual, or are you likely to see a response on repetition? So this is why we repeated the test, usually a day later, but always within 7 days. And what we found was that where you don't see a response when the stimulus is audible, that is not a consistent effect. So it was around about 50% of the time when a stimulus was audible, but we didn't get a cortical response in the first session, we did see a response in the second session. So in practical terms, what this means is we need to be really careful how we interpret non-responses. It doesn't necessarily guarantee that that sound wasn't heard. And what we really want to do to confirm that is to repeat testing where possible. Another thing that we have to be really careful about is how we interpret these responses when we keep doing repeat testing. If we're using this objective detection method with a sort of statistical value to decide whether or not a response is present, of course, every time we repeat the test, we're increasing the chance that we get a false positive response. So it's really important to look at those values with a scientific mind to be aware of the impact of repeat testing. So I really think that's the million-dollar question now. That's something that we would have loved to have found an answer to in this research, but we're still ultimately just not very sure. One thing that did come out of the research was that where the babies were particularly vocal during the session, we were less likely to see a response. But generally, we just weren't sure. It just seemed that there was a significant amount of variability. So I think this area is really ripe for further research and investigation to try to answer that question. We did interviews with parents to ask them about their opinions of the cortical test, and they were really, really positive overall. Some of the parents in particular had struggled to get their babies to sleep for ABR testing, and they really valued that there was a test that they could do with their babies awake. A lot of them also were aware of this sort of gap in the testing, whereby you get some ABR results, they may not be very complete, and then there's just nothing else happening until VRA age. So they were really keen and excited to have this test fill that gap. And a lot of the parents and babies just enjoyed the testing. It's really quite fun playing with the babies, getting them to engage with the toys. So we had really, really positive responses from parents. So there are various ways in which we think aided corticals will help the clinician in their daily practice. One thing is by bringing the parents in and doing aided cortical testing, showing that these sounds can be heard when the baby's wearing their hearing aids may really help to motivate the families to use hearing aids, particularly if they're just not sure whether the babies are responding differently with the hearing aids off or on. Another thing is if you see consistent non-responses, and this includes over the repeat testing that we've spoken about, this is likely indicating that the baby is not hearing through those hearing aids and is one of the tools that can help the clinicians to look at other things such as referral for cochlear implantation. So of course corticals can also be done in an unaided condition, and this is also really valuable. One of the ways in particular in which unaided testing is useful is for patients with ANSD. For children with ANSD, it can be very difficult to determine their hearing thresholds because, as we know, the ABR is likely to be misleading. So corticals can be particularly useful here. Research shows that if there's a response to soft levels on a cortical, it's likely that the child has no worse than a mild hearing loss. And this is really useful information for clinicians and for parents, and to get an idea of what the outcomes might be for that child. It may also be helpful to test children in the unaided condition, in which case non-responses in an unaided condition might help motivate parents to use hearing aids. So we've obviously collected plenty of data out there in a research environment, and what I'm really excited about happening next is clinicians getting out there and using the test in a clinical environment. And I think as we start to see more and more clinicians using the test in a clinical environment, we'll be able to refine our protocols, come up with really strong recommended procedures, and start to see more sort of broader, more interesting benefits than we saw from just the research study alone. One of the things our research showed was that babies who were particularly vocal were the ones who were least likely to show a cortical response even though the signals were audible. So another exciting area for future research is the idea about having a microphone that monitors infant vocalizations during the cortical test. What this means is that information could be used to help make a decision about rejecting epochs during which the infant was vocalising. This could really improve the efficiency of the test.